things. She was so strong, mentally and physically. Working down the bar. She just carried 5 pounds. Like this, you know. And I'd ask her if she needed help. I'd be on balance, you know. And, you know, she was, never weighed more than 20 pounds. But, you know, carrying 35 pounds of water, that was the water of the apple tree. You get up from the water and down the fire. And I'll never forget that. And I was young and in much better shape than I. And this one, I mean, this I just heard from Dad, and this one's a recent one. We are a family of notes, and notes on the stairs, and notes on the counter, and notes in a notebook, and that's never changed, even with technology now, but Dad had said, you know, she had her list, and it was, you know, a bunch of the related medical tasks that she needed to do. Make an appointment with the doctor, take her medicine. But then at the end of that list was, you know, a workout routine. Yeah. And, I mean, she was on the couch at that point. But it just showed that she never gave up. It was never crossed her mind. It was, yeah, when I'm gonna get better, and you know what we're doing next summer and what's happening next week, and so yeah, that was really all I had. But hopefully. On behalf of Strong.
thank you for choosing me as your daughter. You've always told me you pick your parents, and I know I made the right choice. You honored me and instilled in me your spirit, wisdom, and complete love. You're my Kaya. And from the moment I was born, you gave me so many gifts. First and foremost, you shared with me your love of horses, which is something that will live on in me forever. You were one hell of a cowgirl. Your seat was so natural and so easy, and I never saw you take a fall. Ever. You also blessed me with the gift of constant acceptance and allowed me to bloom like the flowers we grew together. I am and always will be your colorful child. You sent me with confidence into the world, and my cat ears, colorful dresses, and fiber bows, which to be fair, I mostly inherited from you. Thank you. I appreciate that you like it. I grew up witnessing true love. That's another gift given to me. My parents showed me what it meant to truly complete one another and emanate unconditional love. I mean, my dad's constant response was as you wish, which he delivered with 110%. I was always given the freedom to excel and question everything and to always find my path. Every time I see a hawk, I'll every time I get too excited, I know it's my third chakra. When I'm upset and can't sleep, I'll use one of your many affirmations. Every time I get goosebumps, I'll know it's the truth. When I get hiccups, I will cherish my excitement. When I'm sick, I will take the spell invasion. Every piece of her wisdom, strength, and beautiful energy will live on in me. She always told me I know how special you are. And I just want to tell her I know how special she was. I'll always be my spirit guide. I promise to always be your colorful child.
Make me an angel. I'm Vicki Sullivan, and I had the great good fortune to have Claudia as my beloved older sister. She was 13 years older than I was. And I watched her adolescence and her teenage years from the perspective of a little kid. And I thought what she lived was normal. So from my earliest memories, I remember finding a box with her schoolwork that always had red A's circled on the top. And I remember finding a box of her watercolors and thinking, yeah, that makes sense that a teenager has this type of artistic ability. And I thought it was normal that handsome young men in tuxedos would show up with corsages and whisk you away. And I thought it was normal that you would be an expert figure skater, an accomplished horsewoman. High school rodeo queen of North Dakota. Miss Wool of Minnesota. That your mother would have this type of picture in your living room. And so you can imagine my perplexity when my adolescence didn't unfold in that sort of way. But what was really amazing about Claudia, it didn't matter to her that I wasn't all the things that she was. She supported me and loved me with infinite love. And I have really amazing memories and also a model that I hope in some ways I can live up to. So I'll just tell you a couple of stories. One of my earliest memories was being in third grade, and she was a college kid who had this amazing life. She was a sorority sister at Tri-Delt. And she picked me up from home, took me to her sorority house, had me sleep over, and took me to her classes. And so I vaguely remember being in a big lecture hall at the University of Minnesota and having a professor comment on the little kid that was seated next to Claudia. And then I also remember when I was in high school, she came home to record music. I had a very newfangled stereo system that would allow you to play a record. I don't know if you know what those are. And also record a cassette. And I was more than happy to have her come home and do that. And I remember clumsily knocking the stereo, and it skipped. And I just cringed, and I felt so badly. And if I knew immediately that if I were she, that I'd be so irritated. And I said, Claudia, I am so sorry. And she said, that's okay, Vic. Every time I hear that record, I'll think of you. And that, it just went to my core. I was like, I wish and I hope that I can have that type of reaction and be that understanding and loving in during life's annoyances. And as I hope I've indicated, we were very different people, but she loved me very, very much, and I always felt tremendously loved, like she was a mother to me. And I remember once she took me, again, very generously, 13, you know, who wants to hang out with a little kid who's 13 years younger than you are? But she took me camping on Madeline Island. And we were hiking around, and we came into a clearing, and there were pine trees. And we walked under the limbs of a pine tree, and there was a circle of mushrooms. And she looked at it and said, Vic, do you believe in fairies? And I said, no. We were very, very different people. But as I grew up, I came more and more to respect her spirituality and her connection with things that we don't understand. And so I gave her more and more respect as a result of that. But she was always looking for something until she found Jeff. And after that, she was happy. I'm sorry to say this. And Matt and Marin made her so complete. And she loved them, her kids, with the fierceness of a mother tiger and the softness of the most maternal human being you can imagine. And I feel really fortunate that 2 years ago, almost to the day, Matt and Lauren and Jeff and Claudia could come out and visit me and my daughters, Joan and Anne. And we had the great good fortune to see Matt marry Maggie. And we were just thrilled to be able to participate in that. And again, I want to emphasize her maternal instinct. And she mothered me, and she mothered me through the most difficult times of my life. And I will be always tremendously grateful. And she had just amazing love for my daughters, Anne and Joan. And Anne wanted me to say how much she loved her Aunt Claudia. She's not able to be here today because of COVID and being in quarantine, so it's breaking her heart not to be here. But as Maren said, and Matt and Jeff, we were very fortunate indeed to have her in our lives. And so may her memory continue to be a blessing for all of you.
Duh. it's just old Luke, and Luke is waiting on Judgment Day. Well, Luke, my friend, what about young Annalee? He said, do me a favor, son, won't you stay and keep Annalee company? Yeah, take a load off Fanny, take a load off.
I'm Joan, Claudia's niece. So anyone who has spoken to me for 15 minutes knows how much I love Minnesota and how I'm coming out here. Like, I have sweatshirts, sweatpants that say Minnesota on them, and everyone I live with calls that the uniform, because as soon as I'm done with classes, that's what I'm in. And a huge part of that is Aunt Claudia and Uncle Jeff. I thought of Claudia as my second mother. She took me on my first few college tours, and she was so excited to do it. I remember I was so nervous to talk to people at colleges, and I was so nervous just to be there. And when I was touring St. Olaf, I was talking to one of the admissions officers, and we were walking, and Claudia was there, and she just let me talk. She didn't, like, talk about herself. She just let me do my thing, and afterwards she told me, like, how proud of me she was for doing that, and it really speaks to her character, because she just encouraged me to just do it and just let me do it. And my twin sister loved her so much too. She's so upset not to be able to be here. And she made sure we always knew, both of us, how proud she was of us in every single thing that we did. And she'll always be with us, just forever. Every part of her, we'll have her forever.
Oh.
Dark belt buckles and faded old Levi's, and each night begins a new day. If she don't understand her and she don't die young, she'll probably just ride away. Mamas, don't let your babies grow up to be cowgirls. Don't let them pick guitars and drive them old trucks. Let them be doctors and lawyers and such. Mama, don't let your babies grow up to be cowgirls. 'Cause they'll never stay home and they're always alone, even with someone they love. Puppies and children and girls of the night. Them that don't know her won't like her, and them that don't probably won't think where to take her. She ain't wrong, she's just different, but her pride won't let her do the things to make you think she's right. Mamas, don't let your babies grow up to cowgirls. Don't let them pick guitars and drive them old trucks. Let them be doctors and lawyers and such. Mamas, don't let your babies grow up to be cowgirls. 'Cause they'll never stay home and they're always alone, even with someone they love. Mamas, don't let your babies grow up to be cowgirls. 'Cause they never stay home and they're always alone, even with someone they love.
You never think you're going to do this. You never think you're going to get up in the morning and go downstairs and lay here in your shirt for your wife's funeral. But it made me realize that, you know, the way I'm going to get through today and the next day is to do those little things one step at a time. But I also want you guys to know that what you have all done here today, the speeches, the talks, the photos, the music, is really more healing for me than you could ever imagine. I mean, I look at it and it makes me cry and it tears me up inside, but it also helps me. And you know, the bottom line is I never thought I would meet someone as amazing as Claudia. And I never thought that I would have somebody like that in my life. And I have told the kids that I spent my whole life, my whole married life, trying not to screw this up. But, you know, Claudia was always wise beyond her years. She came preloaded with the wisdom of the fairies and some greater perspective of life. So what I have to say is much more pedestrian than that. But it is something that we've told in the family. Can I have a Kleenex or something? Yeah. So, what's that? Yeah, okay. So I want to tell you a story. A story of a woman I loved who left me far too soon, before dreams were completed, trips taken, and adventures experienced together. A story that is doomed to failure, because I can never give you even the smallest idea what amazing, adventuresome, wise, and loving person she was, and will always be to me and Maren. And to Matt. It would be as if I was trying to capture the sun and put it in a jar to explain her wisdom that came from her inquisitive spirit, her love of the outdoors, her fascination with birds, plants, animals, and yes, people. I met Claudia in the fall of 1980. It is Claudia who provided the compass for this family. She is our emotional and moral grounding and the one we all turn to when confused by life, our emotions, our situations. She would guide us through, and we would be and are the better for it. But to return to the story, a sort of a family history story. I was sitting in the kitchen of my friend's house in South Minneapolis, talking and catching up as I prepared to get my truck. I had spent the season up in the Boundary Waters camping and canoeing, and I had left the truck with a friend. It was early evening, dusk in the kitchen, and someone walked into the room. She smiled and the room lit up, and I was hit with such an overwhelming emotion. She radiated an amazing energy of joy, of love, of life, of being wholly present in that room and in life. With her was her sister Vicky, and they were headed up to Madeline Island to go camping. Vicky is here today. I am fortunate to call her and her daughters my friends. I will also tell you, I do not remember a thing of meeting Vicky. But to this day, I remember how I felt when I saw Claudia smile. It literally ignited my soul. But it was brief. But they were leaving to go camping and soon were gone. But it had already started. Claudia had returned to Minneapolis from Seattle in July of 1980. Claudia was a believer in the power of the universe, of synchronicity, of however you explain things that seem to happen you cannot fully explain. Her wisdom was the wisdom of a wise woman, of someone who understood things far more than she should for her age. It was her ability to reframe events in the lives of us and in the patients that she took care of as a licensed psychologist that I think turned around and made many lives better. Claudia would often remind me that she had arrived back in Minneapolis from 4 years in Seattle on my birthday, July 20th. She did not think that was a coincidence. So back to the kitchen in South Minneapolis. Claudia and Vicky drove away in Claudia's small two-door green Datsun pickup truck. The truck I was there to pick up was a small two-door green Toyota pickup truck. They left and I left, but the course had been set. I returned later to buy a car from the owner of the house. I was excited about the car, and Claudia was there as we made the transaction. I wanted to go out to celebrate the purchase. It was her friend's car, and while I wanted to ask only Claudia to go out, I felt compelled to ask Claudia and her friend Carol to go out. Carol could not go. Claudia could. I was elated. Our first date was to a little place in South Minneapolis called the Artist Quarter. It was, just as it sounded, rather a small, dark place with a modest beer selection and a performance stage. We walked in, sat down, and on the stage, sitting in a chair, guitar in hand, was a solo blues guitar player named Bonnie Raitt. We both knew her songs and loved her playing, and now here we were together, listening to Bonnie Raitt. We left after Bonnie was done. It was probably 1 a.m., and we drove all night. We drove around the city, out into the country. I drove anywhere and everywhere just so that I did not have to drop her off at the house and leave her. We walked and talked and drove, and I was in love deeply, overwhelmingly, and with a force of attraction I had never felt before. Or since. A day or so later, we went out again. The movie Casablanca was playing in Dinkytown by the U of M. I got out of the car. Yes, I walked around to open the door. Claudia got out. I looked at her, and I asked her to marry me. It didn't feel crazy. It felt as though I was compelled to ask it. There was no doubt in my mind. Claudia did not say yes, but she did not say no. And I could tell that she did not think it was entirely crazy either. But Claudia, being the wiser of us two then and always, just wanted to explore this 6-foot, full bearded hair down to a shoulder guy for a little longer. But remember, she did not say no. I then began my quest not to mess this up. We saw each other every day, and then I did something really stupid. A friend of mine from Camp Minojin and I had scheduled a trip to Nova Scotia for about 3 weeks. I could not believe I was leaving her. I feared it would be the end of the relationship. I thought for sure she'd realize what a mistake she made and would move on. But when I walked into, and we said we'd write, you know, sure, you know. And so I gave Claudia the address, and it was snail mail. And I walked into the post office in Truro, Nova Scotia, and asked for general delivery mail by my name. September 15th. September 17th. This one's somewhere in the middle, but I don't know what the date is. September 25th. September 23rd. And then I got a postcard, September 26th. Thursday, September 25th, dear Jeff, it's not any better. Your letters only make me want you more. Come home. Love, Claudia. And so I came home. We bought a house. We had known each other about 2 months. And we were married the following year. And I just can't believe that I was gifted to be in her presence for as long as I was and as short as it was. And I miss her terribly. But thank you guys for making this just a little easier. I appreciate it so much.
Yeah. You know, I wouldn't tell you that I would.